Ryan Stanton here with ASAP Frontline, joined now by Annette Alagno. She's actually currently in Cape Town, South Africa, and from Uganda, and will return there. And fantastic topic in terms of emergency medicine as a worldwide specialty, Africa being relatively new, right at about a decade old, starting with one program. And as she advised me just a few moments ago, that just opened their 10th emergency medicine residency program in the continent of Africa, just 2 days old from when we recorded this. And so Annette, thank you so much for joining me, and tell everybody about your personal adventure through emergency medicine.
Okay, thank you, Ryan. I'm a Ugandan doctor. I've had quite a long and interesting journey with emergency medicine. My introduction to emergency medicine happened a long time ago in one of the hospitals in Uganda, when I had an encounter with an emergency physician, and I loved the way they approached medicine, especially acute illnesses. If you know anything about Africa, you'll know that African healthcare and even emergency care is poor, it's under-resourced. And for us, we have the highest burden of acute illness. So majority of the people who die get, you know, die from acute illnesses. So for Africa, emergency care is not just another specialty, but it's something that we actually need to drive our statistics around. We have the worst health statistics. We have the highest burden of acute illnesses, ranging from infectious disease, and even non-communicable diseases are on the rise. So we need emergency care, not just emergency medicine practitioners like emergency physicians. We actually need the whole spectrum, right from pre-hospital to EC care to nursing care. We need all those various players in health management to boost up their emergency care skills. So I'm currently doing my residency training in Cape Town, which is an amazing place to train because I get to see a lot of pathology. I get to learn much more than just medicine. I get to learn to advocate for emergency care, which I hope I'm doing right now. I get to meet interesting people, to network, and most importantly, to learn how to manage a unit and how to manage a program, which is part of the training. So why is this important? My country, Uganda, does not have emergency medicine training, and we have very bad health statistics. So for me, it's something that is very important to my career personally, but also to my country. I think for me, it's going to be the biggest thing I can contribute to current Ugandans and also future generations of Ugandans, to make sure that if they have acute illnesses, they are well managed. For me now, being at SMAC is an opportunity. I was actually sponsored to come to SMAC by the SMAC committee, which I think is a very good gesture for emergency care in low and middle-income countries. If you go to America and the US, emergency care is very well developed there. They are now doing things that I look at and I'm like, wow, dropping things using, what is it called that we had yesterday? Oh, you need to remind me, Ryan.
The fact that we actually witnessed them do a resuscitation from a car, destruction of a car, in the intro.
Exactly. I was just like, okay, when will I, that's for me is like watching a movie, because I don't see that conceivable in my environment. For me, it's right down to the basics. But this is important because it helps us to aspire to try to be as close to perfection as we can, and in that way we can build a good, strong, sustainable system. And for high-income countries, yes, they're very well-funded, but even in Africa, much as we are rudimentary and it's poor, there's lots of things that are cross-cutting, and it's very, very clearly coming out from this conference. Things like fatigue, we have very high patient loads. They have the same. Things like managing a team, we have the same issues. Things like feeling overwhelmed, alone sometimes, under a lot of pressure. Things like burnout. Those are things that are cross-cutting, right? Even in the high-income countries and low-income countries. So for us in Africa, it's a chance to learn, to mitigate these things as we go, because we can learn some things from you guys despite our different contexts.
Well, I think if you if we continue to see the focus on trying to destruct emergency medicine in the U.S. with politicians and things like that, you may end up with a lot of Americans coming that way. It's great to see this, very young burgeoning system, that's gone from one program to now 10 programs in a decade. But still, I mean, that's clearly, Africa's a very large continent, many countries involved. And so it's still very much undercovered. I'm sure extensive areas of the continent that is underserved, significantly underserved. How do you see this evolution of emergency medicine in Africa over the last decade?
So the first emergency medicine physician graduated in Cape Town 10 years ago. A woman, I'm very happy to say. And Cape Town was the first place in Africa to start emergency medicine training. So it's a joint division from both UCT and Stellenbosch. And this is slowly spread across Africa, of course, driven by the need for improved emergency care. And in 2009, there's a formation of the African Federation for Emergency Medicine, an organization that incorporates all players in emergency care in Africa, both African players and non-African players, who are literally the friends of AFEM. And AFEM has now partnered with the World Health Organization to drive the development of emergency care across Africa. We are about to host the fourth conference of emergency medicine in Africa in Rwanda. The first was in Ghana in 2012, I think, then 2014 Addis. And last year, it was in Egypt. So next year is going to be in Rwanda. And that is really the only conference of emergency medicine in Africa. There's also a journal that's run by AFEM, the African Journal of Emergency Medicine. It's the only journal on emergency care in Africa. I'm sure if you think of the U.S. where you're from, I don't know how many emergency medicine journals that you have. How many roughly do you have for a very small population?
Well, it depends on if you're counting, the major journals through the two major organizations of emergency medicine in the U.S., but then also the what we consider the throwaway journals, those that are more newspaper-based. But there's, that's one thing we don't have a shortage of in the U.S. is journals and people trying to get information out, and that is, the harder thing for us is to narrow down what is quality as opposed to quantity. It's almost overload with a lot of the quantity, but the quality is what we're having an issue with now, with the number of publications trying to get something out there.
Okay, so clearly you don't have access issues like we do. We have only one journal, and even then there is not enough access for the emergency care providers that need it. It is it's free online, and authors are encouraged to publish an African, African context papers in the journal, and to get the message, people actually need it. What's the other developments we have apart from the training? We've got the South African triad score that is widely used across the world. It's probably the most widely used triad scale in the world. It's used in Afghanistan, it's used by the MSF, it's used across many different countries in Africa, and it's something that started in a very small rural hospital in South Africa, and it's grown, so that's a good achievement for Africa. The IFEM president, the current IFEM president, is also from Africa. Lee Wallace. That's also another celebration. The most recent ISEM was held on African soil, and we had very good representation of Africans. Why? Because of SuperDel. So SuperDel is a way to support emergency care providers attend conferences on African soil. So every time you register for a conference, and SMAC is also listening to it now, and it's something that they are promoting. Every time somebody from a high-income country, say, registers to come for the African conference on emergency medicine, a proportion of that money goes to supporting people who cannot afford within Africa to attend that conference. And in that way, they create networks, build their own knowledge, and take this home and improve emergency care in their settings, which I think it's a great thing to do. The other thing that we're pushing for is author aid. You don't have to come to Africa to support African emergency care. Like Ryan, you could register for author aid online. and support an African researcher to get published. You could also register for Author Assist and just help to develop the knowledge of African researchers and improve their skills and make sure we have more papers that are coming in that are very context specific to us, so that I'm not reading about Rubowa in a rural community where I cannot even get adrenaline to manage my sepsis patients. And I'm like, no, I don't need Rubowa now. I need adrenaline. Yeah. So simple things like that.
What are the greatest challenges facing the further progression and growth of emergency medicine in Africa?
I think one of the things is knowledge about emergency care as a specialty in medicine. It's a new concept. It's only about 10 years old in Africa, and compared to other more traditional specialties that have been there for decades and decades and that people are more accustomed to, their roles are clearly defined, what they do is already known. So even in training, there's very few places where medical students are exposed to emergency medicine as a specialty during their training. So very few of them will take it up as a specialty. I was lucky. I was exposed by some chance and I absolutely loved it. But there is that. The other thing is policies. Without good governance, you just cannot drive anything. So if we have ignorant policymakers who do not understand the system, do not understand the new things that can actually help them improve just generally healthcare, then and it's not going to be reflected in the health policies, and therefore it's not going to be driven, it's not going to be funded, and it's not going to happen. So one of the things is we need to do a lot of advocacy, talk to our policymakers, the ministries of health and the permanent secretaries, all the people that write the budgets, all the people that are responsible for attracting funding, both government funding and funding from donors, get them to see that emergency care actually worked. Where it's applied properly, there is evidence and there is clear reduction in patient morbidity and mortality. If they can see that, if we can have more research, if we can have more people speaking about this, if we can have more conferences in Africa where we can invite these players. They don't have to be very scientific, but they could just be policy-related conferences. And when they know about it, then they will support it.
Now, one of the focuses of your talk, and I think it's, and it may be more of an extrapolation on my part, is the removal of these silos between emergency medicine in places like North America, where it's you know, very mature, even though it's still only 30, 35 years old, even in the United States, as well as Europe and countries like that. How do we break down those silos and become an emergency medicine community, global community, as opposed to what we're doing now, which is very much living in our own silos?
You're actually unpacking my talk. Listen, it's about connections. It's about using our everyday tools, in quotes, like Twitter, like Facebook, and more traditional things like meeting and talking to people face to face. It's through connections, it's through building collaborations, it's through networking, it's through discussing issues that actually matter, not only to your context, but that are applicable across, that are cross-cutting. And if people get to talk more about it, I'm very excited today that there's a lot of talk on Twitter about breaking this down. And Flavia made a very strong statement. Low and middle income countries don't need to be patronized. We just need opportunities, because we have people that are passionate. We have people that can do a lot of things, but we're limited by lots of things. We just need the opportunities to do what we can do and improve care for health populations back home. Yeah.
So you've mentioned a couple already. So we're talking about, you know, 1,000 plus emergency physicians, you know, a day listening to this podcast. And you know, they're sitting there. I'm sure that the rest of the world is not blind to the frustrations of U.S. healthcare and the politics that are going on now and the fights and everything else that's going on that is the circus of U.S. politics. What can you know, U.S. physicians, North American physicians, others that may listen through connections here at SMAC, what can physicians do to help advance? Because I think, you know, really the definition of a doctor is a teacher. And it's not just a teacher of patients or families. It's also a teacher of future generations at home and abroad. And, you know, that's, I think there's a wealth of knowledge in people, many here at this conference, that that would jump, I mean, myself included, jump at the opportunity to help advanced healthcare in other countries, because it's an opportunity to really make a difference. Whereas in our home countries, and especially me in the United States, I feel like many times we're beat down just constantly with the fact that we are so utilized and all the changes that are going to take place. How can we make a difference?
That's a very, very good question, Ryan. And listen, to make a difference to emergency care in Africa, you don't have to travel to Africa. You don't have to.
Even though I think many of us would love to travel to Africa.
Welcome. You're welcome. We'd definitely love to have you in Africa so you can eat real food and enjoy the sun. And yeah, you don't have to go through the whole process of vaccinations and planning your holiday and doing all that. You don't. You can contribute to emergency care online. So just log on to afm.info, and then you can look at Superdel. You can attend our conference and contribute. You can contribute. You can contribute money and support an emergency care provider from deep down somewhere in Africa to attend a conference on African emergency care in Africa, from where they will learn, get skills, get knowledge that they can apply back home. You can do lab research.
I personally hate research, but I love people who do research.
Yes. So they can join author aid and author assist. So you improve the knowledge of researchers, and then you help them get published. And one of the barriers to emergency, to improved and better quality emergency care in Africa, is the lack of research. I'm not tired, but I have read so much about American statistics that many times don't make sense because they're not applicable to my setting. We need African researchers to do research in their contexts so the things can be applied, so we can know what's applicable in our setting. What are the gold standards for Africa? Not the US, where they can do whatever they want, but how do we take the science that has been proven to work in America, where they have all the resources available? How do we then translate and adapt that to our African setting, where we have different population characteristics, we have different resources, but we have the same problem? Sepsis is sepsis. If you're in America, if you're in Africa, it is sepsis. And some things have been proven to work. But how can we adapt that to our setting? We can do research on that. Yeah.
And that's, you know, to me, it's an issue we face in U.S. healthcare is, you know, so much of our research is done in these larger center referral tertiary care hospitals that is difficult to translate into the community or rural setting, you know, smaller hospitals where, you know, on nights and weekends, it is only the emergency physician. You know, you still have the resources of U.S. healthcare and the referral networks and things like that. But, you know, so much of many of these conferences I listen to and I think, well, how does that apply to the 80% of hospitals that are not in larger cities or not associated with large referral centers and robust networks? And, you know, and I think there's a huge amount of opportunity throughout. So, you know, fantastic information, and exactly what I was hoping for when I was reaching out to you to come talk with us for ASAP Frontline. And hopefully, I don't think you need to worry about whether you're advocating or not. The number of listeners and U.S. physicians that will listen to this and hear it and hopefully be inspired as an opportunity to actually make a difference, because I think that at heart, you know, physicians around the globe are are well-natured, motivated, and want to help. Systems, people, physicians, patients, no matter where in the globe they're going to be located. How can folks get in touch with you? Spell out the website one more time, and then how can folks get in touch with you via Twitter or email?
Okay, you can read about Emergency Care in Africa at afem.info, so www.afem, that's A for Alpha, F for Foxtrot, E for Echo, and M for Mama, .info, that's I-N-F-O. And you can look at the different aspects. My Twitter handle is at A-Alenio, that's Alpha Alpha Lima Echo, November York Oscar. And you can get me at the email aalenio@yahoo.com.
All right. So Annette Alenio, fantastic information. And thank you for joining us here on ASAP Frontline. If you have any questions for me, because as soon as we get done talking, I'll start brainstorming on things to do. You can contact me, youreverydaymedicine@gmail.com, youreverydaymedicine@gmail.com, or at everydaymed on Twitter. And until next time, I'm Dr. Ryan Stanton, and this has been some ASAP Frontline.